Hello friends, today we are going to start a new topic of operating system, and that topic is process. We are going to discuss following points during this presentation. We will start with the need of process. We will define the, what is the definition of process actually, and how we define the process in terms of operating system. Then we will discuss various process concepts like process introduction, process stage, process control block, which is also known as task control block. We will also discuss some process scheduling topics like scheduling queues, what is the meaning of scheduling, and the meaning of context switching. Later, we will discuss operation of the process, how to create a process, how to communicate the process, and we will define and we will discuss the concept of operating process and inter-process communication. Let us start our discussion. First, let us define the concept of process. We know that operating system executes variety of programs. In the base system, there are various jobs of same types, and these jobs are executed by the CPU when these jobs are loaded in the memory. The time shared system, user programs are executed. So, a process is a program in execution. A process is more than a text action. A process execution must be progressed in the sequential fashion. It means, whenever we execute any program, for executing that program, the operating system creates a process, and it is the responsibility of process to execute all the instructions that are written in the program in sequential fashion. A program by itself is not a process. Same, because a program is a passive entity, such as a text file and then a list of instructions stored on the disk. But a process is an active entity that includes program counter, values of various CPU registers, stack to store temporary data, data section to store global variables and heap, and memory is located dynamically to run at a runtime. A program counter is a small register that contains the address of the next instruction to be executed in the program. During the operation, a process modifies the value of various CPU registers. The exact number of CPU registers depends on the type of architecture. During the operation, it needs stack, data section, and heap. So, now the process can be defined in a program in execution. An instance of the program running on a computer is an active entity that can be assigned to and executed on a processor. Or more precisely, you can define a unit of activity characterized by the execution of the sequence of the instruction, a current state, and associated set of resources. Let us discuss process state. We know that when a program executes, it changes its state. It means the process can migrate between one stage to another state. There are various stages during the execution. For example, initially, whenever a process is created, it may be in the one state. And whenever a long-term scheduler selects a process from the job queue and that process is loaded in the memory, again, it changes its state. Whenever a short-term scheduler selects one of the processes that is loaded in the memory, again, a process changes its state. It means whenever you execute a process can migrate from one state to another state. A state of the program is defined in a part by the current activity of any process. There are five states. Initially, a process in the new state. Whenever a process is created, at that time, a process is in the new state. The next one is ready state. Whenever a process is selected by the long-term scheduler, a process changes its state from new to waiting. It means it is waiting for the CPU to be allocated, and whenever a process is loaded from the job due to the memory, it changes the state from new to right. During the execution, whenever CPU select one of the process from the memory and start execution, during the execution, it may be possible that the process is waiting for some IO to be completed. At that time, a process changes the state from ready to waiting. Then the state when the instructions are being executed and terminated, state is a state when the process has finished all of its tasks. Only one process can be run or any processor at any instance where many processes may be ready and in the waiting state. This is a diagram that is showing any state of the process. Initially, the process is in the new state. Whenever a process is loaded in the memory, it is in the ready state. And whenever a short-term scheduler selects one of the process, it changes the state from running to ready to running. During any if any interrupt occurs, again the process changes the state from running to ready. And during the execution, if the process is waiting for some IO event, it changes the state from ready to waiting. And whenever IO event completes, again it changes the state from waiting to ready. During the execution, if a process executes all of its tasks, it changes the state from running to terminating. The next topic to be discussed is PCB. Now the question is, how a process is stored in the operating system? The simple answer of this question is, a process is represented in the operating system by the process control block. That is why this is also known as task control block. The PCB contains various pieces of information associated with each process. For example, it stores process identifier. A process identifier is a number, unique number that is added with each process. This is used to uniquely identify each process in the operating system. So next field is process state. We know that a process migrates between or among various states during this execution. So in this field we can store any state like running, waiting, new or terminated. A program counter is one of the register in the computer that store the next instruction in the program to be executed. So this field of the PCB contains the next instruction to be executed. CPU registers, during the execution a process can change the value of various CPU registers available in the computer. So, the exact number of CPU registers and their types depends on the type of architecture. This CPU register includes accumulator, index register, state pointer, flex register, and other general purpose registers. CPU scheduling information. A PCB also contains this field that stores scheduling parameters like process priority, pointer to be. Pointer to scheduling queues, etc. During the execution of every process, it needs memory for reading and writing some information. So, we also need to store memory management information in the PCB. The memory management information depends on the memory used by the operating system, includes value, base register, limit register, page table, segment table, etc. The next field that are included that is included in PCB is accounting information like amount of CPU time and the real time the time remaining job and process numbers. IO status information, list of various IO devices allocated to the process, list of open files and so on. This is a simple diagram of process control block. You can see various fields, the first field is pointer. Process state, process number, process counter, registers, memory limits, and list of compiles. This diagram is showing how CPU switches from one process to another process. For example, here process P0 is executing. During the execution, if any interrupt occurs or any other process requires the CPU and the priority of that process is higher or any selection criteria, we can choose to switches from one process to another process. So whenever a process is execution suspended, the operating system saves the state of that process in the corresponding PCB, and in the execution, the remaining time the CPU is idle. But in between these two states, we can execute another process. In this diagram, we can see that whenever a CPU is idle, the operating system reloads the state of another process P1. So the PCB of that process is loaded in the memory. It will start execution, and whenever any interrupt or system call occurs, the execution of that process is suspended. So the operating system saves the state of that process P1 in the PCB 1, and later it can reload the PCB of one of the process. The exit selection of the process to be executed by the CPU depends on the CPU scheduling algorithm. Process scheduling. We know that the objective of multiprogramming is to have some process running all the time to maximize the CPU utilization. And the objective of time sharing system is to switch the CPU among various processes so frequently that user can interact with each program while it is running. To meet above objective, process scheduler selects an available process from the ready queue and allocates CPU to it. We know that whenever you want to execute any process, first you have to load that process into the memory. So whenever you load any process from the job queue, it is available to the CPU for the selection. So this selection is known as process scheduling process. In a single processor system, only one process can acquire the CPU. If there are more processes, then rest will have to wait until the CPU is full. During the process scheduling, the operating system maintains various types of queues of processes. An example of these process queues are job queue, ready queue, device queue, waiting queue, etc. So initially, what is job queue? We know that whenever a process is created, initially it is in a new state. So whenever a process enters in the system, it is put in the queue, and the name of that queue is job queue. This queue consists of all the processes in the system. The next one is ready queue. This queue is a set of all processes residing in the main memory. It means all of the processes in the ready queue are in the waiting state. They are waiting for the CPU to be allocated. This queue is maintained, generally this queue is maintained as a linked list where ready queue header contains the pointer to the first and the last PCB in the queue. And each PCB contains the pointer to the next PCB in the queue also. Device queue. Whenever you execute any process, it needs various resources, various devices. So we also need to maintain device queues. So device queue maintains set of processes waiting for the IO device. Each device maintains the device queue in the system. You can see various types of queues using this diagram. The first one is ready queue. The ready queue header contains the pointer to the first PCB and the last PCB in the queue. The remaining are device queue. The first device queue is the magnetic tape. No process is waiting for the magnetic tape 0 and magnetic tape 1. But here, at least, there are three processes are waiting for this to be allocated for the execution. So, this header contains the pointer to the first PCB as well as the address of the last PCB in terms of pointer. The the green diagram can be used to represent various cues in the process scheduling. Generally, in the green diagram, we use various types of symbols. The first type of symbol is rectangle. Rectangle box represents the cue. For example, ready cue, device cue, each device acts separate device cue. Circle represents the resources that serves the cue. And the arrow represents the flow of processes in the system. Using this diagram, you can see whenever a process enters in the system, initially in the ready queue, whenever a scheduler selects one of the process from the ready queue and CPUs are located to that process, again it changes its state from ready to running. During the running, a process can either terminate it or can insert it in another queue, like it can be entered in the waiting queue or in the ready queue. The first case is whenever a process is executing, and if any IO request occurs, the process will enter in the waiting queue. There we have various IO devices queue, and whenever IO device is allocated to that process, again it changes from changes its state from waiting to ready. In the time sharing system, whenever a time quantum expires, time size expired, the process changes its state from running to ready. In case of child process, whenever a process creates another process, the execution is given to the child process. It means the first child process finishes its execution and then the parent process is resumed its execution again. The fourth case is whenever any interrupt occurs. So whenever any interrupt occurs during the execution, we have to solve that interrupt. So the execution of the current process is suspended until the interrupt is handled by the interrupt handler. So again, it changes the state from running to ready. Scheduler. We know that the process migrates between the various scheduling queues during its lifetime. Operating system selects processes from the queue according to some scheduling algorithm, and this selection is carried out by the scheduler. There are two types of scheduler. Long term scheduler is also known as jet scheduler. For example, whenever a process is in the new state, the long term scheduler select one of the processes from the that job list, and it's assigned, it is loaded in the memory, system memory. For the select, this process should be brought into the ready queue. Generally, this type of schedulers are used in the page system, in which the more processes are submitted and can be executed immediately. These processes are stored in the mass storage, where they are kept for the later execution. The job scheduler selects from the job pool and loads them into the memory for execution. The other type of scheduler is short-term scheduler. It is also known as CPU scheduler. It means the CPU scheduler is a scheduler that selects one of the processes that are loaded in the memory and start the execution. So it decides which process should be executed next and allocated to CPU. It selects from the ready queue and allocates CPU to one of them. It means long-term scheduler selects one of the process and changes its state from new to ready, where the short-term scheduler selects one of the process and changes its state from ready to execute or running. The short-term scheduler is invoked more frequently, generally in the order of milliseconds, so it must be faster. Where the long-term scheduler executes less frequently compared to the short-term scheduler, so it may be slow. The long-term scheduler controls the degree of multi-programming. How it is? So, for example, whenever there are some processes in the job queue, the long-term scheduler select one of the process from the job queue and it loads in the memory. But the memory is not free. There is a limit for the memory that it can occupy. It can store only limited number of processes at a time. If there are n number of processes that are already in the memory and there is no space for the new process, the new process cannot be loaded. That is why long term scheduler controls the degree of multi-programming. Degree of multi-programming is number of processes that can be designed into the memory at a time. Process can be described as either I/O bound process or CPU bound process. As the name implies, I/O bound processes spend more time doing I/O operations rather than computation. So, I/O bound processes may have short CPU burst time, where the CPU bound processes spend more time doing computation rather than I/O operations. So, few very long CPU burst time required for the CPU bound processes. The third type of medium-term scheduler. The most of the system, long-term scheduler may be absent. So in this type of systems, we can use the medium-term scheduler. It removes the processes from the memory. Later, the process can be reintroduced into the memory and its execution can be continued where it left off. This scheme is called swapping. So the process is swapped out and later swapped in by the medium term scheduler, and it is used to reduce the degree of multi-programming. You can understand this concept with the help of this diagram. The ready queue is maintained. The short term scheduler selects one of the processes from the ready queue. The CPU is allocated to that process. Now we have various options. During the execution, if the process finishes the execution, it will change the state from the running to terminated. But if any interrupt occurs, the partially executed process is swapped out of the memory. And again, whenever that interrupt handled by the interrupt handler, it will be swapped in again into the memory. So again, it is inserted in the ready queue, tab of the ready queue. At the same time, if the CPU is waiting for some IO operation, it will change the state again, and after performing the IO operation, it will again inserted at the tab of the ready queue. Context switching. We know that process migrates between various states. So, context switching is nothing but a situation when a process changes its state. Whenever CPU switches to another process, the system must save the state of the current process and load the save state for the new process. This task is known as context switch. The context of the process is represented in the BCD. When context switch occurs, the operating system saves the context of the old process in the PCB and loads the PCB of the new process. This context switch time is overhead because during this context switching, the system does not do any useful task. Now we are going to discuss what are the various operations we can perform on the process. Generally, processors perform various operations on the process during their lifetime. This includes process creation and process termination. These are the major tasks performed by the system on process. How to create a process? Whenever a process is created, what are the various parameters that are to be stored in the BCD of that newly created process? And whenever a process is terminated, how to release all the resources that are allocated to that process? The first operation is process creation. Whenever a program is executing by the CPU, That program is the CPU or the operating system creates a process to execute that program. But during the execution, a process can create another process. So in this case, a process, whenever a process creates another process, the created process is known as child process. The parent process creates children processes, which in turn create other processes, and in this way they can form the process tree. We know that whenever a process is executing, it needs some set of resources for execution, for performing all the tasks that are used by that process. So there are various schemes how the child process acquires these resources. So one of the schemes is a child may be able to obtain resources directly from the OS. We can also share the resources of parent and children. In the third scheme, children share subset of the parent's resources. In the last scheme, parents and the child share no resources. It means the parent and child having different set of resources for execution. When a process creates a child process, two processes exist in terms of execution. The first one is parent and child execute concurrently. Another scheme is parent wait until the children come. It's the exact scheme that is used by the operating system, depends on the type of operating system. Some processes allow parent and child execute concurrently, where another operating system does not allow this scheme. And in that, another scheme is parent wait until the child terminates. Again, there are two possibilities in the terms of address space of the new process. So, first thing is child duplicates the parents. It means child and process share the same address space. And in another scheme, child has a program loaded into it. The initial example of creating the process is a fork system called create a new process. Child process and the parent process share the same address space in case of Unix. Whenever you create a process using fork, allowing parent process to communicate easily with the child process, both parent and child execute concurrently. This is the process tree of Unix system. Next type of operation is process termination. A process executes last statement and asks the operating system to delete it by using the exit system call. While for creating a process, create process system call is used. So whenever the process is terminated, the child process returns data to its parent, and all the process's resources are relocated by the operating system. The parent may terminate execution of the child process by using abort command. For the variety of reasons, there are variety of reasons why they are responsible for aborting the child process by the parent process. The first situation when the child has exceeded the allocated resources. If n number of resources are allocated to the child process, and if the process requires another set of resources, the parent process can terminate the child process. Another situation is when the task assigned to the child is no longer required. And the last one is that parent is exiting. If the parent is terminating, all the process, child process must be terminated. Some operating system does not allow child to continue if his parents are terminated. The case facing termination, if the parent is terminated, then all the children must be terminated. The term for operating processes. Processes that are executing concurrently in operating system may be of two types. The first type is independent process and another one is cooperating process. So what is independent process? A process that cannot affect or be affected by the execution of another process is known as independent process. A process that does not share data with another process is also independent process. Where the formatting process is a process that can affect or affected by the execution of another process, it means a process is sharing some data with another process. The advantage of formatting process is information sharing. During the execution, if two processes want to share some piece of information with each other, they can share and at that time, these processes are known as formatting processes. Computation speed up. Whenever a process fails to execute, the task of that process can be acquired by another process. Modularity and convenience. Inter-process communication is a mechanism for processes to communicate and to synchronize their action. There are two models for inter-process communication. The first one is shared memory model, and another one is message passing model. In the shared memory model, the region of the memory is shared by the formatting process. All the processes communicate with each other by reading or writing this shared region. Where the message passing model, in the message passing model, the communication takes place by means of message exchange between the formatting processes. In this scheme, we use the fixed or variable length message formats to exchange information between two processes. Generally, message passing is useful for exchanging small data, where the message and the message passing scheme is easier to implement. Only we need to share only a small region between two processes. Where the shared memory allows maximum speed up. Shared memory scheme is faster than the message passing because the message passing is implemented by issuing system calls. First, message passing model. The communication takes place by means of message exchange between the cooperating processes. The inter-process communication facility provides two operations, send and receive. These are the system calls that are used to exchange information between two processes. The actual message to be passed to another process is passed as an argument in the send and receive messages. In this case, the message length may be fixed or variable. If there are two processes P and Q, they wish to communicate, they need to establish a communication link between them and exchange messages via send and receive messages. It means whenever two processes want to make the communication, the communication link must be established between these two processes, and any message that exchange via that communication link will be delivered or will be sent by a particular sender and receiver respectively. The implementation communication link may be physical or logical. If it is physical, it is implemented by the shared memory and hardware bus. And if it is logical, there are some logical properties you can send and receive the messages. What are the naming conventions? The processes that want to communicate must have a way to refer each other. And this scheme is known as naming. How a process refer to a particular process in the same system, this scheme is known as naming scheme. There are two communication schemes. The first one is direct communication, another one is indirect communication. So in the direct communication, process must name each other explicitly. In this scheme, the send and receive primitives are defined as send, and we pass two types of arguments. The first P and another one is message, then P stands for the process who is sending the message. The receive message, again we are passing two arguments, Q and messages. The meaning of this format is receive a message from process Q. It means if we are passing an address or any name of the process in the send message, it means P is that process is sending the message to another process, and that receiver is known by the first parameter in the send message. So what are the properties of communication link in direct communication? So in direct communication, links are established automatically between the communicating processes. Process need to know the only each other's identity. The link is associated with the exactly one pair of communicating processes. It means no other process can use that communication link for exchanging the information. The communication link is established between two processes. Only these two processes are used to allowed to use that communication link for exchanging the information. Exactly one link exists between the each pair of processes. The link may be bidirectional, but usually it is a bidirectional. It means both sender and receiver can send and receive the message. If there are P and Q, there is a link established between the process P and Q. It means process P can send messages as well as can receive the messages from the Q. But in case of indirect communication, messages are sent and received from mailboxes. Each process has a unique mailbox. The process can communicate only if they share the mailbox. Properties of the communication link are: the link established only if the process is shared from a common mailbox. Another property is a link may be associated with many processes. It means a single communication link can be used to exchange information among various processes. Each pair of processes may share several communication links, one pair for each pair of processes. Link may be unidirectional or bidirectional in this case also. So what about the operation case of indirect communication? First, we create a new mailbox, and this mailbox is shared between two pair of sender and receiver. One pair of sender and receiver, it means only that a single mailbox is used to exchange information between only two processes, where one process is used as a sender and another process is used as a receiver. Send and receive messages through this common mailbox, and we destroy the mailbox when two processes do not want to send or receive messages. The primitives for the functions send and receive are: if we are passing any process name or identifier and a message, it means send a message to mailbox A. It means A is sending method. A reporter is sending a message to A, where in the receive, the meaning of this primitive is receive the message from mailbox A. It means in case of send, it is used as a receiver. In the receive, it is used as to identify the sender. Synchronization. The message passing model may be either blocking or non-blocking. The blocking is considered as a synchronous, and non-blocking is considered as asynchronous. There are four possibilities in case of blocking and non-blocking. We may have blocking send. It means sending process is blocked until the message is received by the receiving process. If a sender sends any message to the receiver, the sender cannot send any message to another process until a receiver receives the message. It means the sender is blocked. No blocking send. It means sending process sends the message and it resumes its operations. Blocking receive. A receiver is blocked until message is available. It means a receiver cannot receive the message from another sender in case of blocking receive. But in case of non-blocking receive, a receiver either declines or a valid message or a null. While we are exchanging information via some communication link, there is a possibility that that sender is sending the message faster than the speed of receiver to receive that message. So in that concept, we must know the concept of buffering. So, in case of speed mismatch of sending and receiving messages, A message action between the communication processes reside in temporary queue on the communication link. In this communication link may have some messages. A queue of messages addressed to the link can be implemented by three ways. The first one is zero capacity, another one is bounded capacity, and third one is unbounded capacity. So in the zero capacity, no message can reside on the communication link. In this case, the sender must block until the receiver receives the message. Bounded capacity. It means the finite length of n messages can reside on to the communication link. Thus, at most n messages can reside on the communication link. If the queue is not full and a new message is sent, the message is placed in the queue and the sender can continue the execution without waiting. It means in bounded capacity, sender must be blocked if link is full. The last one is unbounded capacity. In unbounded capacity, infinite length, the length of that unbounded capacity offering is infinite length. Thus, any number of messages can reside on the communication link. It means sender never blocks. Let us conclude what we have discussed today. We started our discussion with the definition of process. How a process is created, what are the various characteristics of a process, how a process changes state from one process to another process, what are the various process states, new, waiting, running, calculated, etc. We also introduced the concept of process control block. It is a way of storing the information related to the process. Then we will we discuss process scheduling, various scheduling queues, what the meaning of schedulers, and context switching. We discuss operation of the process, how to create the process, how to delete the process, operating process, process communication, tracking models, message passing, and shared memory model. And what are the naming schemes used in process communication. And we ended our discussion with the concept of buffering.